I am Garth Herbert, Chair of the Canadian Diabetes Association, and it's my pleasure to introduce the Isabel Lockerbie Address. This year's address is being given by a woman who's been described as a cross between Oprah Winfrey and Bridget Jones. Although she's perhaps best known by her personal brand, Champion of the Underdog. Diagnosed with type 1 diabetes 19 years ago, Sandy Struss's condition hasn't slowed her down one bit. And I'm sure you'll agree with me that her smile and her energy is contagious. She's been involved in the diabetes space for a long time as a passionate volunteer, patient advocate, and powerful motivational speaker, having spoken to audiences of both patients and healthcare professionals across the country. Sandy is the founder and president of peoplewithdiabetes.ca, an online community for patients designed to unite, inspire, and connect patients together in a spirit of support and empowerment. In addition, she runs a type 1 diabetes support group here in Vancouver, and her day job is a marketing manager for Animus Canada. In her spare time, Sandy is also a writer with her own column called The Underdog, where she shares stories of ordinary people living extraordinary lives. With all that she does, Sandy says her aim is to be a force for positive change in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, with her message that we're all in this together, this year's speaker of the Isabel Lockerbie Address, Sandy Struss.
Look at this room. Oh my goodness. I sat in one of these chairs about 3 years ago, listening to the Isabel Lockerbie Address, and I said to myself, gee, you know, I'd really like to do that someday. And that someday is now. It's a little surreal. I mean, there's always a little bit of drama that happens when I'm speaking, and so far this morning, it's been pretty good. You know, I haven't tripped on the way up here. I didn't drop the microphone in the toilet, which is a good thing. I gotta tell you, I did that on my very first corporate speaking engagement a few years ago. It was one of those things where I'm pacing, I'm totally nervous, and I'm going into the bathroom to relieve myself. And, you know, I'd heard this from other speakers that, you know, make sure you turn the volume off before you go in there. So I had it turned off, but didn't think of, well, when I unzip my pants, the whole unit would fall into the toilet. It was one of those things like in a movie where you see, you just want to go, no! Thankfully, the toilet was not contaminated as of yet at that point, so I could fish it out and take it, and then it was just soaking with water, so I'm patting it off with toilet paper, and then I've got a cameraman outside, and I bring it out to him, and I say, is this salvageable? You know, what, can you fix this at all? And he opens it and all this water comes out of it. And it's just a disaster because it belongs to the hotel. And of course the tech guys are having a field day on the walkie-talkie saying, speaker dropped the microphone in the toilet. We need a new unit here. And you know, the interesting diabetes part, my blood sugars went from 6 to 26 without my having eaten anything. I mean, the adrenaline was just coursing through my veins. It was crazy. There was another really sort of funny story that I had traveling in Barrie, Ontario. I was speaking at the CDA's Live Smart Diabetes Expo. And, you know, I was in a hurry. I travel a lot. And there's always a certain pair of pants that I wear when I'm speaking. So, you know, I throw the speaker pants in there, throw everything into the suitcase. And then I show up in Barrie the evening before the presentation. So I'm putting the pants on that evening, you know, to see where I'm supposed to iron them and so on. And I'm starting to do them up and I realize, oh my God, the zipper will not go up. Like, what is the problem here? Because I had, you know, packed on a few pounds, I'd started a new job and all of that stuff. And all of a sudden, my speaker pants don't fit and I don't have a backup. So I'm in my rental car running through Barrie, Ontario, trying to find a mall that's open on a Friday night. And all I got to tell you is God bless the Gap. At 5 to 9, I had a pair of pants to wear for the next day because it was either going to be that or track pants. But so far today, we're in pretty good shape. Where is the remote? Here we go. Now, this is a bit of a full circle moment for me to be here because, you know, I once thought that I would have a future in medicine. My dad was a GP in Kamloops, so I kind of grew up with that in the family, and I was always really good in sciences. And so the plan was for me to then go into medicine and take over dad's practice and all would be well in the world. And then when I turned 17, I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. And everything changed. And my poor mother, I think I gave her so many gray hairs, it's crazy. Within the next 8 months, I left home to leave for university since my diagnosis. And let's just say that I did all of the things a non-compliant patient does, all of the things that you're not supposed to do. I was like an animal let out of the cage, and needless to say, my grades suffered. So in my first year of university, I had almost failed physics and calculus, just made it by the skin of my teeth, and my dreams of going into medicine were over. But thankfully, I had a good fit. I switched over into business and marketing and loved that right away. And what's ironic now is that it was diabetes that kind of ended that initial decision, but now it's diabetes that has actually brought me back to be here with you today. And what an incredible honor it is. I mean, the who's who of diabetes in Canada is here in this room. Wow. Now, today is also significant because my mom is here somewhere out there. She doesn't get the opportunity to. Oh, there she is. This is what she looks like. And I've got some friends and some family. My colleagues from Animus are here. I mean, a lot of the folks, I don't speak a lot locally. And they had said, well, when's a chance we can come to see you speak? And I said, well, if they're kind enough to let you in here, I think we might be able to smuggle you in. Because they often wonder, well, what the heck is it that she actually does anyway, you know? So I'm thrilled that you're here. But more importantly, I'm most excited because I'm here with you. The everyday heroes that are working with people and making a difference day in, day out, every single day. It's an honor to be here. Each and every person that is in this room, regardless of what your occupation is, if you're a researcher, if you are a doctor, if you're a nurse, if you're a dietitian, if you're a pharmacist, if you're a patient, you're a volunteer with the CDA, you work for the CDA. I mean, everybody is involved and has a role to play in this diabetes community and in the big picture of what we're really up to. Now, in the big picture, as Dr. Vinicor had said at the opening address, I had forgotten what his name was. I had to write it on my hand. He had talked about the horrifying statistics of diabetes. The growth is just exponential, and we can't possibly hope to keep up. I mean, the system is fundamentally flawed. I mean, unless we look at taking care of poverty, unless we look at getting people the treatments and the medication that they need, and the people to educate them, the resources, how on earth do we hope to get a handle on all of this? You know, that we have a drug review system, the common drug review, which isn't transparent. We don't know why certain things get passed, other things don't get passed. And ultimately, as patients, for us, in terms of having the option to have the best treatment possible, there are constant roadblocks to that. And it's a fight all the time. And for you, I mean, we're talking about, you know, making a difference, and we're all in this together. What can one person do? And so you may ask yourself, well, geez, you know, it's so overwhelming. There are so many problems. You know, I'm only one person, and you know what? The patients don't listen to me anyway. You know, how do I possibly hope to make even a dent in this mammoth thing called diabetes that's now taking over our culture? You know, over the last few days, I've been kind of doing a little survey of some of you and kind of asking what some of your challenges are. And the number one response that I had time and time again was the volume of work and the ability to manage time and how much there is to do. And the demands are just getting more stringent all the time. I mean, there's more patients coming down the pipe. And if the ones that aren't doing well are coming back, they're kind of plugging up the system for those that are newly diagnosed, and there just aren't enough resources to go around. It's enormously frustrating. I can't imagine what it's like. And then, of course, how do you motivate the patients? You know, I hear this so many times as well. Well, you know, they come in, they listen to me, they look at me, they nod their head, and then they go away, and then, you know, they come back 6 months later, and we go through the same thing again, and nothing has changed. You know, where is the missing link here? So where are my ladies from Prince Edward Island? Oh, there they are, there they are. So this next little digression is thanks to you, because it was at the welcome reception, and I kind of ambushed them and started asking them a few questions, and they said, well, hey, Sand, you know, what was it that worked for you? So just from my experience, here's some of the things that helped me really kind of take charge and be responsible with my diabetes, just as an example. The first thing for me was acceptance of diabetes and the diagnosis. And you'd be surprised, because I'm someone that puts on a really brave face and, oh, all is well, there's all this bravado. But yet the acceptance of, this is my life now and this is who I am, and to stop resisting the anger at having to deal with something that I didn't choose. That only really started to happen probably in about my late 20s. But what a difference it made, because there's a difference between being a, to put this in Winnie the Pooh terms, to be an Eeyore, you know, someone that's always whining and sniveling and complaining about the way things are, and to be a Tigger, you know, someone that just takes it on and is happy about it and is sharing. And you know what? Something very interesting happened to me, and you'll get a good chuckle out of this. Those of you that know me know that I've become a bit of an exhibitionist, because every taxi cab driver and every airport security official, oh, look, I have an insulin pump. Oh my goodness, do you know how this works? Oh, do you know about diabetes? You know, and of course, it's crazy, but it's an incredible educational tool. And once I accept that I have a role to play, this is the thing that I've been given, everything is an educational opportunity. The next thing was kind of a, I guess you could call it a spiritual awakening, in deciding that there are no accidents, and that maybe there's something at play here that is much bigger than me that I just don't see yet. So I started to look at, okay, so this is my lot in life now. What can I do to somehow use this as a tool and as a gift to be a better human being, to be a better member of society, to somehow be part of something that's bigger than me? So I started volunteering with the CDA, with the JDRF. You know, I started off doing educational speaking engagements to corporations about the prevention of type 2 diabetes. But my favorites were the kids in the elementary schools. You know, my favorite group was definitely the third graders. The little ones, I think they're getting smaller, either that or I'm just getting a whole lot older, but they're so tiny. And at the time, I was on still my syringes, and the moment I pricked my finger to show how much I have to test my blood, and they're like, oh, ew. But they're fascinated at the same time, and they're like sponges. They totally get it. So we started talking about carbohydrate counting, and, you know, and that piece of candy over there, this is what actually happens in your body. And if you had diabetes, here's what you would have to do. And then instantly, it's so amazing why over the course of an hour, at the end of the class, you hear kids talking about, oh, let's see how many grams of carbohydrates are in that. You know, like it's the most rewarding thing in the world to finally be part of something and to give meaning to this condition. And probably the best thing I did was to join a support group. Because as much as we appreciate and have gratitude for our educators and those that have good intentions for our health and our well-being, there is still absolutely no replacement for somebody who lives with it. And it's only when you go through the same thing that you have that instant kinship with somebody that knows. And there's a freedom and a humor around diabetes that you have, because, you know, it isn't perfect. You know what the terror of what a low feels like. You know, and when things get out of whack, how do you get that back together again? You can have a level of conversation with people that have been through the same thing, and it was enormously helpful because then I was no longer so alone. But probably the biggest thing was finding a higher purpose. And I got to tell you about a defining moment in my life. There was a gentleman by the name of Peter Legg that I met back in 1998 or so. It was one of those moments that was very unexpected. I was introducing him at an event because he's a big time speaker and a publisher and all of that. And so I was just doing his intro, and then he came up to me afterwards and he said, "Kid, you got something special. You should join the Professional Speakers Association and become a speaker." And I just thought, what? I mean, it's not exactly something you tick off on your college application as choice of, oh, this will be my major, you know? And what on earth would I possibly say that would have any value to anybody? I mean, great, but what do I do with this now? But it was a defining moment because I started to then look at, well, what could I speak about? And diabetes became a major platform for me. Now, many of you who have heard me speak before will know this story, so bear with me because it's part of the bigger picture of the message here today. This young man is someone who, unbeknownst to him, completely changed the entire trajectory of my life. I was looking for what my direction was. What is my brand as a speaker? Where do I fit? How does this all work? And then one day, at the Sydney Olympic Games in the year 2000, this man came to swim. He's a 22-year-old named Eric Musambani. He's from a little country called Equatorial Guinea in Africa, a country I'd never heard of before. And he holds the distinguished record for having the slowest recorded time in Olympic history for the men's 100-meter freestyle. But what he went through to get there to the Olympic Games was magic. I mean, he started to swim 6 months before the Olympics. And because he came from this little country, if you were the only one who applied, to be the swimmer, then you got to go. But here's the thing, in Equatorial Guinea, they don't have big swimming pools. So he learned how to swim in a hotel swimming pool. So when he showed up at the games, he had never swum the full distance of 100 meters before. So as you can well imagine, he's just a little bit frightened. So he's in the first heat of the men's 100 meter free. And of course, this is in Sydney, in Australia, where it's a swimming crazy country because the world record holder, Ian Thorpe, is Australian. So there's not a free seat in the house. It's just filled up to the rafters. And of course, there's cameras everywhere. And I mean, this was hilarious to watch because, I mean, there's Ian Thorpe, is the big, tall Australian guy. And he's got his Speedo fast skin suit on. And he's got his, I think it's like size 14 feet. So essentially they're flippers, you know? And he's got his game face on. And you can tell, I mean, he means business. He's out to set a new world record in his home country. And then, you know, there's little Eric that's just kind of, looking around and is it almost my turn yet? And he's got his little Speedos on with the string hanging out. He doesn't even have a bathing cap. You know, he's got his little goggles done up super, super tight. And he's going, to make sure he can see. And the strap's kind of flapping in the wind a little bit. And he's completely terrified, you can tell. Now, to make matters worse though, here's the thing. So the other two guys that he's supposed to race against in the water are disqualified for jumping the gun. So he is now, by himself, with the eyes of the world watching, having to swim a race he has never swum before. So the gun goes off, and he goes into the water, and his arms are going like propellers, 100 miles an hour, and he's going, giving her the whole time. But he's rapidly losing steam as he's kind of getting towards the 50-meter mark. And he had learned how to do a tumble turn about 3 days before. So he kind of looks up and sees the wall, does the little turn. You can almost see him smiling with pride that he actually did it. And then he starts on his way back. And this is where the magic started to happen, because the crowd sensed that they were seeing a miracle happened for this man, because he's getting a lot slower as he's starting to come into the second half of the race. And you're thinking, there's no way he's gonna make it. Like, somebody get the raft, or what they do on the stage, they grab the cane, to help him along or something. You don't think he's gonna make it to the end. And ever so slowly, you can feel the lactic acid in his muscles, just how heavy all of it must be. But he finally touches the wall, And the crowd, I mean, they're on their feet cheering and cheering and cheering. And, you know, he kind of looks around and he realizes, well, this must be for him because he's the only one in the water. And he cracks this big smile and, you know, kind of climbs out of the water. But this was the best moment, is that, you know, he gets out and he kind of looks at the crowd and he raises his arms in victory. Because for him, that was his personal best. And those are the kinds of stories that I think we need to see so much more. You know, who's telling the story of the fourth place finisher? Who's telling the story of the last place finisher? And each of those people has worked just as hard to be there, and their journey for how they got there is ultimately what defines their character at the end of the day. And I think from my own perspective, you know, that's how I became champion of the underdog, because I thought somebody's got to be telling these stories. And Lord knows, our kids these days need better role models than the ones that the media is portraying. So this is my mission as champion of the underdog. Now, I believe that every single one of us has an inner underdog. Now, what is that? It's the little voice inside your head that dares you, kind of eggs you on to be great. It's the little thing that gets you to act in spite of fear when you're completely terrified. It's the little thing that has you care a little bit more than you have to. It's the little voice in your head that, if you're too busy, you kind of let it go. But if you were to listen, boy, the quality of your life just explodes. Because, you know, at the end of the day, whenever the jig is up, whenever is your last day on the planet, you'll never remember the awards or the plaques on the wall or all the stuff you've accumulated. What you'll remember are the moments and the journey of what it took to get to where you are in your life and the people you got to interact with. Because the reality is, none of us is guaranteed a tomorrow. You know, I have diabetes, and I'm quite blessed in that I've got quite a vivid perspective on my own mortality. But you know what? Any one of us could leave here, you know, somebody runs a stop sign and it's game over. So what goes in my mind every day is like, okay, now is all there is. So I gotta make the difference I'm here to make today. Wow. Now, I love this slide, the power of one, the ripple in the water, because it all starts with one little drop and continues out until you can't see it anymore. And there was such a beautiful, beautiful metaphor that was used by Dr. Vinokur in his opening address, where he was talking about cobwebs and how each of us, when we have our own little cobweb, that it's a very fragile piece, fragile but beautiful piece, but the power of them brought together can tame a lion. And I thought, isn't that how we change the world? Every single one of us has something to contribute. Now, I'm just going to show you an example of the ripple effect in action. Now, down in Africa, there was Eric Musambani, you know, this kid who goes to the Olympic Games, goes to Sydney. The entire world sees this race, and he has upstaged the world record holder by being the last guy. Then in Canada, somebody finds herself, finds her place in the world, who she wants to be because of that race that he swam. And then I got to share with you, I mean, everything I have done as champion of the underdog and as a speaker and so on has been inspired by that moment by Eric. And so I got a website and I read a column and all these things. And, you know, you always wonder, does any of this make a difference? Does anybody actually read this stuff? And a couple of weeks ago, I got an email from a gentleman in Texas, of all places. And I'm going to just read you a few lines of what it says. Says, Sandy, I can't thank you enough for all you're doing. I'm a high school social studies teacher in Houston, Texas, and have recently started Feel Good Fridays, in which we start the class off with some kind of positive article of some sort. I've used some of your archived writings as well as your underdog stories. The kids love them. I wish you all the best. Please keep up the great work, Tim Hurlburt. So here's this guy in Texas that is sharing these stories with young kids. And can you imagine what will happen? I mean, something, an initiative by one teacher starts Feel Good Fridays, the sort of positive messaging that he delivers to the next generation, and then who they go on to become. I mean, that's the sort of stuff you can't even begin to imagine. And my big dream, actually, is to meet Eric Musambani and to be able to thank him for the gift that he gave to my life. Now, there's about 100 people I could put on this list that have contributed to various defining moments in my life. You know, Peter Legg was the guy that kind of put me onto the speaking thing. Eric was the one that, you know, found my personal brand and so on. And then there's another one which I believe you'll appreciate. Does anybody in this room know this lady? Her name is Deli Patterson. Where are my gals from Kamloops? Where are the ones from Royal Inland? Oh, there you are. Perfect. She is a dietitian from Royal Inland Hospital in Kamloops who was there when I was diagnosed 19 years ago. And she was someone that really made a difference for me at a time when I was in crisis and I was alone. And it was the most simple gesture that she gave me, just the most human thing, but it has stuck with me for 19 years. But of course, I didn't remember her name, but I remembered exactly what she looked like. I remembered her smile, and I remember what she said. So about a month ago, I'm in Kelowna at another speaking engagement, and then sure enough, you know, the gals from Royal Inland are there, and I thought, oh, maybe they know this lady. I don't know her name, but maybe if I describe her, they'll know who she is. So sure enough, they say, oh, that's Deli. I had said, well, she's got dark skin, she's really, really short, and has really kind eyes, and she speaks with an accent, but I don't know her name. And they said, oh, she's retired now, but yeah, we know Deli, absolutely. So the wheels start turning in my head. They know her, they know her. What can we do here? Is anybody else an Oprah Winfrey fan in this room? Now, that's not actually a real photo. No applause yet. This is the real photo. Ted Koppel, yes, but I've got a fabulous designer that makes it mine. You know, you gotta dare to dream big. So one of my favorite episodes of Oprah was about teachers. And it was this guy that came back 25 years later after he had graduated to honor a teacher that had made a difference for him when he was in high school. And he was like this inner city kid with no guidance. And it was so beautiful because the man who had inspired him was a music teacher. And he had grown up to actually become a music teacher and to create a music program for any inner city school kids. And I thought, oh my God, this is the most beautiful thing ever. You know, like, who would I do this for? So I started thinking, okay, maybe we could put together an Oprah-style ambush. If they know who Deli is, we could bring her together. Maybe we could create a moment like this. Now, obviously, I'm not really pals with Oprah, but you know what? I can do something. So I get on the email to Evelina, and I say to her, do you think, you know, I really want to create this surprise. You know, can you help me with this? And she says, oh, absolutely, no problem. We'll put it together as like an old timers luncheon because they had invited a couple of the other retired nurses to come down to the Diabetes Education Center on the Saturday, on the 13th. So I thought, okay, good. So the date is set. I know I'm coming. I'll bring flowers. This is good. But how can we expand this even more? So I thought, well, while this moment will be great for me in Deli, wouldn't it be incredible if I actually had a cameraman that could capture the moment and then share it at this conference? And wouldn't it be great if the local media actually might pick up on the story too, so we could spread the goodwill of this event, of what's happening, this woman who's made such a difference in my life? So, you know, I get on the email to CFJC TV and I say, okay, guess what? I'm coming into town to surprise this lady. She has no idea I'm coming. She probably won't even remember who I am, but I'm here to thank her. And so they pick up the phone, they call me. We love this story, we'll be there, it's terrific. So I'm like, yes, we got the TV, okay. Then I'm thinking, okay, well, if something happens, I probably need an independent cameraman, but I don't know anybody there. So I'm kind of calling out to all of my contacts to say, who do I know that can help me? and an old neighbor of mine when I grew up in Kamloops is now a city councillor. So I pick up the phone and I call him. His name is Arjun Singh. I go, Arjun, okay. So I'm planning the surprise and I need a Kamloops connection. I need some help. Do you know a cameraman by any chance? And maybe can you do like a plaque from the city or something like that for the Diabetes Education Center? Because these women work so hard to serve these patients and I really think they should be acknowledged. And he says, well, it's a little bit short notice for that, Sand, but you know, I know this camera guy, maybe he'll be able to help you. And I'm like, for cheap, okay? Like, don't have a lot of money. So someone that maybe might want to volunteer their time, you know? And so sure enough, he found me a wonderful man who came up on that day to be part of this moment. I've also emailed NL Radio there because I thought, okay, so let's go through all of the channels. And so the day of the event, my mom and I are actually in the ladies' room in the mall, and my phone rings. I'm like, oh my God, who's calling me? And I'm in the bathroom, and I pick it up. Oh, it's NL Radio. Guess what? They want to come too. So now this event has kind of expanded and is getting bigger all the time. And then 10 minutes later, I get another call from CFJC TV that, oh, sorry, we can't make it. There was a fire overnight in Pritchard. We can't get there on time. We wish we could. Sorry about that. But we had a cameraman there. So what I'm going to share with you now is the footage from that reunion. And it was a wildly emotional day for me because it's someone that had made such a profound difference in my life. And what I want you to consider as you watch this is that each of you, I'm sure, has an army of people that feel the same way. We're about 10 minutes before showtime, and I have waited 19 years to be able to thank this woman for what she did for me. So I just can't believe this is about to happen. Now, the reason this is so special for me today is when I was admitted, I was all alone. My parents were on a cruise at the time that I was diagnosed with diabetes, and I didn't have anybody here to be with me. And so the team at Royal Inland Hospital really took care of me, and Deli in particular. I remember one moment I had with her, and she's been with me every day since. I just can't believe she's almost here, and I'm going to get a chance to thank her for who she was for me.
You seem a little overwhelmed by it all. What's going through your head?
Yeah, definitely. You could say that. When you're given a diagnosis that you're going to have to take injections every day for the rest of your life, you just don't even want to believe it. And it's so overwhelming and so suffocating almost. It's just, you need somebody there that's going to tell you it's going to be okay. And I was on my own. And so to have this lady come and simply be there with me from one human being to another, that moment gave me what I needed. And I think the message in doing this here today to anybody else who is in a service profession is when you can have a moment with somebody, they may remember that for the rest of their life and may never have the opportunity to thank you for that, but it's a moment that lasts forever. Deli? I'm here as a surprise for you. You may not remember me, but I brought these here for you. My name is Sandy Struss. I was admitted to Royal Inland Hospital with type 1 diabetes 19 years ago. My parents were away on a cruise at the time, and there are two things that I remember about being here. And one of those moments when I came in, they said, oh my God, it's a miracle that you're not in a coma. I had blood sugars of 56 at the time. And so much of what was happening around me was such a blur. And I don't remember much of it at all, but I remember you. And it has been 19 years, and I have always wanted to come and acknowledge you and thank you for a moment that we shared. As I remember, I was lying in my bed and you came and you held my hand. And you said, don't worry, we'll help you. And that was exactly what I needed to hear. at that time, because I was never more alone in the world than at that moment. And for what you did for me on that day, that's why I'm here. It's kind of an icon.
I don't remember. But all I remember was the sound of your name, because we see a lot of people here. And Deli, your name sound familiar, but what I said and what I did was...
It was a moment. It was absolutely a moment, but it was what I needed, and it was a part of the next 19 years of my life.
Oh, dear.
I'm calling it sort of my Oprah-style ambush here today, because everybody else is in on this. And I don't have like a car or a trip or anything like that to give you, but what I do have for you is a promise, because of the kindness that you gave to me, my promise has been to pay that forward to everybody that I come into contact with as well, and that magic has stayed with me for 19 years. So I wanted to give you these.
I'm shaking.
I am so glad that I did a difference in my life.
For those of you who work with patients, you have opportunities for moments like that every single day. And just like Deli said, I mean, it was just another patient, another day at work. We see a lot of people here. But for me, it was a life-changing moment. And can you imagine, for all of you in this room and all of the lives that you've touched, what a legacy you must have of people out in the world who owe something, some little something that you've given to them. That's the difference that you've made. And you may never know. You know, there may not be someone that shows up with a cameraman and flowers and so on. But you've got to know that you make the difference. And you know, you don't even have to do anything more than just show up and be who you are. I was in an airport recently and saw this little book by Kermit the Frog, and there was a quote that I opened up in there that I want to share with you. It doesn't matter if you're a frog or a pig or a bear or even a person. It doesn't matter if you're a big fish in a little pond or a small fish in a big pond. You're you, and you matter. Now, the final clip that I have for you is something really special, because I did a shout out to the diabetes community, to the patient community, to say, you know, I'm coming, I've got this great opportunity at this conference, and I'm wanting to put together a piece of faces of diabetes all across the country. So many of you may recognize your patients in this next little video. And I just ask you to consider that there are hundreds, if not thousands, of others who feel the same way.
Thank you.
The world needs you. And we are better off because you're in it. So for all that you are and all that you do, we salute you and we thank you. Godspeed to you all.